First speaker in this last session is Dr. Rama Jayashankar. He will be talking on the role of Vedic mantras in Ayurveda.
And I'll be talking about mantras, the role of mantras in Ayurveda. So I'll be speaking on the role of mantras in Ayurveda. And before I go on to the topic, I would like to give an introduction to Ayurveda, because without understanding the context, you know, how and where and why Ayurveda uses mantra, right? To understand that context, it is important to know how Ayurveda looks at health and disease and in what context mantras are used in Ayurveda. So Ayurveda, as you all know, is the science of life. It is made of, it has two words, Ayu and Veda. Put together, it means science of life. And because it's a science of life, it deals with health and also disease. When it deals with health, it talks about preventive and promotive health. And when it talks about disease, it talks of how to handle, how to treat the diseases. And we also know that Ayurveda is indigenous not only to India, but to the entire Indian subcontinent. It has uninterrupted medical practices going back to a conservative estimate would be about at least 5,000 years. It's one of the most systematically documented medical systems in the world, and it's not an empirical medicine, but it's a theory-based practice. So when we talk, so Ayurveda has two aspects to it. One is the health. The other is the disease. And when we talk of the role of Ayurveda in handling disease, it's a clinical medicine. And the two major factors that are important in clinical medicine, any clinical medicine, be it Ayurveda, be it homeopathy, be it allopathy, are diagnosis and treatment. So all clinical medicines, whichever systems they are, they begin with diagnosis and end with treatment. The treatment is defined by the diagnosis. And the diagnosis is defined by how the human system is understood. And something else defines how the human system is understood. It is defined by how the reality is understood by the basic sciences which have contributed to these medical systems. We should remember that no medical system is a fundamental science. All are applied sciences. There are basic sciences which contribute to the development of these clinical systems. If you look at modern medicine, the basic sciences which have contributed to the development of modern medicine are physics and chemistry, right? So the how the physics, how the subject of physics has understood the reality is reflected in the way that modern medicine has understood the human system as well. So if there are two systems of medicine which are different, the difference begins from here, from the world view. So if you look at modern medicine, the world view of modern medicine is also the world view of physics, which says that the entire world is made of building blocks. Now this is reflected in the way modern medicine has conceptualized and understood the human system. So when you say something is made of a building block, you can actually reduce the bigger block to smaller ones, right? So here the larger object is the human system, and you can see that how the human system is reduced to the fundamental level. So this is the model that has been adopted by modern medicine. We study these in our schools, how atoms make molecules, molecules make organelles, then you have cells, tissue, organ, organ system, and the entire organism. So this is reductionism, because the entire organism is reduced to the fundamental level, and there is a focus on the structures. Now this structural viewpoint of modern medicine is reflected in everything that they do, be it diagnosis, be it treatment, be it diet and nutrition. Now let's look at Ayurveda, the science of life, and let's begin with the world view which has helped Ayurveda conceptualize the human system. The worldview of Ayurveda is the worldview of the Vedas. The Vedic worldview talks of interconnectedness. It says that nature exists as a continuum, and the universe is a dynamic web of interconnected and inseparable entities in a dynamic relationship. So you, and this is in stark contrast to the building block model adopted by modern medicine and modern science. And so let's see how this different understanding of the reality is reflected in the way Ayurveda has conceptualized the human system. So Ayurveda talks of four different domains in the human system. They talk of a structural domain, they talk of a physiological domain, there is a psychological domain, and the domain of consciousness. Now each of these domains is interconnected, it's networked within, and you can also see these areas of overlap there, which means that they are interconnected as well. So this again, you know, you can see at the right top hand corner, the model adopted by modern medicine and biology to understand the human system, which is based on a structural hierarchical model. And you can see the gross difference in the way the two medical systems has understood the human system, right? So we are talking of Ayurveda right now as a clinical medicine which can handle disease, right? So for this you need to have some way to classify and categorize the system, and which Ayurveda has done in two ways. It talks about the sthula sharira and the sukshma sharira, and you see that other classifications which comes under the gross and the subtle. So and the gross body, that is the sthula sharira, is classified in three different ways. One is based on structure, this is grossly physical. Then there is also a functional classification which is based on what is called dosha, and this covers physiological and psychological. Then there is a system wise classification which is based on what is called srotas, srotas means channels, and this encompasses physical, physiological and psychological. And then it talks of the subtle, the sukshma sharira, which talks of the subtle level and the realms of awareness. In yoga it's called panchakoshas, and this is considered in Ayurveda as part of the subtle domain of consciousness. Now let me very quickly give you some idea about this functional classification based on dosha, because this runs as an undercurrent to the entire Ayurvedic understanding of health and disease. Not only understanding, but in the way that Ayurveda handles health and disease, these dosha functional classification plays a major role. So when you say functions, there are many contributing factors to a function. A function is an emergent property. So from structures to biochemistry to various activities, I have listed some of them on the slides. All these together, put together, and many more parameters which I have not shown on the slide, all these together contributes to a function, right? So a functional classification is going to be very different to that of a structural classification which modern medicine has adopted. And you can see that in the functional classification, structure and biochemistry, which are the mainstay of modern medicine, is included is part of function. So Ayurveda has identified three major functions in the body: movement, metabolism and growth. And in the context of Ayurveda, these are called Vata, Pitta and Kapha. And for convenience, I'm going to refer to these as VP and K. And all the psychophysiological functions. So Ayurveda never delinks body and mind, be it in understanding health, be it in understanding disease. It never delinks body and mind. So all the psychophysiological functions are classified, can be categorized and explained under this broad-based classification of Vata, Pitta and Kapha, each of which is subclassified into 5 subtypes each. So between these 15 subclassifications, all the psychophysiological functions can be explained in Ayurveda. So VP and K cover not only the psychophysiological functions, but what makes it a pragmatic medical system is the second point here. It includes biophysical, chemical, physiological and also psychological parameters. So what the ancient Ayurvedic acharyas had done was that they had identified three major functions, and under them they have grouped together a group of parameters which are biophysical, chemical, physiological and psychological in nature, which impact these functions, right? So these are some of the parameters that Ayurveda talks about. I would like to mention that although all these terminologies are in English, the information is taken from classical Ayurvedic texts. So Ayurveda talks about biophysical, properties like dryness, fluidity, viscosity, stiffness, elasticity, weight, and so on. It also talks about chemical parameters. Of course, it doesn't use the word pH, but it uses the word amlatvam, which is a reflection of pH. It uses the word temperature. Temperature is something that's very well defined in well-defined parameter in Ayurveda. And interestingly, you see all these, some of the psychological parameters, indices, which are classified under Vata, Pitta and Kapha. So this is just an example of how these parameters that Ayurveda talks about are connected with each other. So this shows a network of just these parameters, these biophysical parameters are all connected with each other. And when this, so V1 to V7 represent parameters, biophysical properties which comes under Vata, P1 to P7 comes under Pitta, and K1 to K7 comes under, or parameters which comes under Kapha. Now, when this network is in balance, it denotes health, and when it is disturbed, it is a disease. So disease is a system perturbation in Ayurveda. And the job of the Ayurvedic doctor is to get this back to balance. So because Ayurveda has understood the human system based on Vata, Pitta and Kapha, they have brought onto the same platform all parameters which impact health and disease. Health and disease. So for example, plants, which are used for medicine, they are also part of our diet. Animals, again, they are used, animal products are used for making medicines, they are also part of our diet. Lifestyle activities, environment, all these are classified and categorized in terms of Vata, Pitta, Kapha. So when the clinical symptoms are also classified in the same way. So when a patient approaches an Ayurvedic doctor based on the clinical symptom, which would be coming either under Vata, Pitta or Kapha, so the symptoms can reflect either the VP or K separately or a combination. So when the diagnosis is made based on these Vata, Pitta, Kapha, all factors which increase Vata have to be avoided. All factors which decrease Vata are prescribed. So this is the, in a very, very simple way, this is how Ayurvedic diagnosis and treatment works. So the therapeutic approach in Ayurveda is very, very comprehensive. Diet and lifestyle activities is the first line of treatment. And then you have medicines, then there are procedures, then there are non-physical interventions like meditation. So medicines and procedures comes under physical interventions, and diet and lifestyle activities also are under physical interventions, and then meditation comes under non-physical interventions. So just to go through what comes under physical and non-physical interventions. So Panchakarma, which falls under these procedures, Panchakarma, medicines, food, they come under gross physical intervention. Then you have a subtler physical intervention, which is in the form of lifestyle, for lifestyle changes. For example, exercise comes under that. And yoga also comes under a physical intervention because of the postures that are adopted. And mantra, if the mantra is chanted or listened to, then it comes under a physical intervention. It may not be a gross physical intervention, nevertheless, it is a physical intervention at a subtler level. And the non-physical interventions would be yoga, where in the higher levels of yoga, and meditation, and the contemplation of mantra. When a person does not chant or listen to mantra or even read, but they contemplate it, they meditate upon it, then it comes under the non-physical intervention. And counseling, of course, it comes under a non-physical intervention. So mantra as an intervention is physical when it is chanted or heard, and it's non-physical when it is meditated upon. So with this huge background information, let me go on to quickly to the kind of mantras that Ayurveda talks about. There is not too much information about it, because many a times, the text just say that mantras have to be chanted, in this condition, but it doesn't say which mantras. And because Ayurveda is part and parcel of the Vedic literature, so one has to go back to the Vedas and other related literature to find out which mantra has to be used. So the mantra is can be used in different realms. And so these are some of the mantras that I have quoted with the reference from the Charaka Samhita, which is one of the canonical texts of Ayurveda. So mantras are used, suggested or prescribed for treating psychiatric illness. And surprisingly, for the treatment of fever, of course, you know, there are lots of medicines which are also prescribed for the treatment of fever. But it's also mentioned that in fever of unknown origin, they say that, you know, Vishnu Sahasranamam has to be recited. And there are mantras which are chanted during the delivery time period of the for the women. And when there is the illness because of poisoning, then there are certain mantras that are recited during that time. And Jatakarma, the ritual which is done for the newborns. So there are a number of references for that. And during the Jatakarma, the mantra is chanted near the ears of the child. And it is mentioned specifically that honey and ghee should be mixed together, and it should be impregnated with a specific mantra and then given to the newborn. And there is also mentioned in the text of an earthen jar filled with water which has been exposed to chanting of specific mantras. And this earthen jar filled with the mantra exposed water should be kept near the head of the child. There are also mantras which are mentioned before collection of herbs for making medicines. And not all medicine, but there are certain medicines which are mentioned, specific names of medicines, and it's said that there are mantras have to be chanted during a particular time of the day and month before preparing these mantras. So I think that was the last slide. So I stop here, and I end with this universal proclamation of Ayurveda, which again is what is said in the Vedas. May all be happy, may all be healthy, may all enjoy prosperity, may none suffer. So this is a translation of Sarve Bhavantu Sukhinaha, Sarve Santu Niramayaha, Sarve Badrani Pashyantu Ma Kaschit Dukha Bhagavet. So thank you very much. I once again thank Dr. Sushrut for giving me this opportunity. Thank you.